Hi guys, it's Claire. Welcome back, and welcome to the nonfiction edition of my best books of 2018. Like many people, I love this time of year and seeing everyone's best of lists. I once again read enough fiction and nonfiction this year to warrant splitting my lists in two. So I'll be coming at you tomorrow with my best fiction reads of 2018, but until then, let's get into the best nonfiction books I read this year, starting with my least favorite and moving to my most favorite. First up, I have The Fall of Language in the Age of English by Minae Mizumura, who is a Japanese writer with a fierce loyalty to her native tongue, and this book is her fascinating look at the rise of English as the world's universal language and the consequences that has for national and local languages and for national and local literatures. And she spends a great deal of time in this book looking at the rise and fall of national and universal languages over the course of history, and she spends a lot of time looking at the development of Japanese in particular. And she carefully considers all of the cultural and literary and linguistic nuance and specificity that are lost as more and more bilingual writers choose to write their books in English. And Mizumura is a force throughout this book, unapologetic and provocative as she argues for a more vigilant safeguarding of the integrity of local and national languages. And whether or not you ultimately agree with her, she makes a strong case for all that is gained and lost in an increasingly interconnected and global literary landscape. And I read this book way back in January and then went on to read a fair amount of translated books this year, and I was so glad to have all of these points and ideas at the back of my mind as I read those books, so I recommend this book in general, but especially for lovers of translated fiction in particular. Then I have MEATY by Samantha Irby, which is a book of humorous essays about Irby's life as a single woman in Chicago just trying to get by. And she's not trying to bag a guy, and she's working a kind of dead-end job in an animal hospital, and she's really just trying to find humor in the absurdity and the mundanity of the everyday. And I would say that Irby's two primary modes in this book alternate between being baffled and exasperated by all of life's bullshit, and although she is hysterically funny throughout, amid all the light and frivolous things that she comments on, she's also at times able to weave in serious discussions of things like illness and addiction, race and sexuality, all with the same humorous and sarcastic touch throughout. So I would recommend this book for anyone who loves Broad City, and although Irby's humor can at times be a bit crude, I really mean it when I say that Crohn's disease has never been this painfully funny. Next up, I have South and West by Joan Didion, which is a collection of notes and reflections from a month-long trip that Joan Didion took to the Deep South in the summer of 1970. And as a hardcore Joan Didion fan, I absolutely savored every withering observation and slick detail in this book. It's really a testament to what an incredible writer she is. She's also kind of the platonic ideal of a coastal elite, and her sense of disorientation and disdain is like a constant foreboding hum throughout this book. And although her California condescension is palpable on every page, her observations are so sharp and evocative that you kind of just accept her regional bias for what it is. So I wouldn't necessarily recommend this as the best place to start with Joan Didion, but for her established fans, this is an immensely rewarding and satisfying read, and it also has some of the best sentence-by-sentence writing that I encountered in any book this year. Next up, I have Like Eating a Stone, Surviving the Past in Bosnia by Wojciech Tochman, who is a Polish journalist who traveled to the Balkans in the early 2000s to chronicle the aftermath of the Bosnian War and the genocide that took place in that region from 1992 to 1995. It was a conflict that left more than 100,000 people dead, many of them Bosnian Muslims who were killed as part of a Serbian ethnic cleansing campaign. And for much of this book, Tochman follows the widows and mothers and children of the slaughtered, many of whom are still searching for the remains of their loved ones, whose bodies were thrown in unmarked mass graves or scattered throughout dense mountain forests. And Tochman's prose has all the restraint and quiet reverence of an empty tomb. This is a searing and incisive portrait of a deeply divided region reckoning with its very recent history. And it's an account that raises many troubling questions, chief among them, how does a country or a region return to some semblance of normal life after a conflict that displaced hundreds of thousands of people and tested the limits of human cruelty? This is certainly a sobering and unsettling read, but I highly recommend it for anyone interested in the Bosnian War or in the Balkans in general. Then I have Barracoon, The Story of the Last Black Cargo by Zora Neale Hurston, which is the remarkable account of Cujo Kasala Lewis, who's one of the last known persons to make the forced journey from Africa to America across the Middle Passage in 1859. And this is a story that Cujo Lewis relayed to Zora Neale Hurston toward the end of his life in the 1920s, much of it told from the steps of his porch in Mobile, Alabama. And what's so remarkable about this book is that it puts down in writing the story of a person who experienced life and capture in Africa, who weathered the Middle Passage, and then experienced all of the horrors and the cruelties and the absurdities of slavery in America, and who then went on to witness the Civil War and Reconstruction and the fresh injustices of Jim Crow in the South. His life spans a remarkable breadth of American history, and yet it is also the story of one man, and Zora Neale Hurston beautifully captures Cujo's voice and all of the tangents and moods and different tenors of his storytelling. And she also captures all of the tremendous pain and injustice he experienced throughout his life. So this book is remarkable both as a historical document and a literary achievement, and it also is a testament to Zora Neale Hurston's tremendous talents as an anthropologist and a collector and chronicler of Black stories and Black folklore in America. And last but not least, I have The White Book by Han Kang, which was one of my favorite books of the whole year, and I have to preface this by saying that the U.S. edition of this book is coming out in February and is listed as fiction and a novel. But this book is really quite experimental and difficult to categorize, and when I was reading it earlier this year, I was fully under the impression that I was reading something between memoir and prose poetry. So category fraud be damned, I'm putting it on this list. Regardless, this is an absolute gem of a book, an exquisite meditation on life and death, grief and beauty, and the transience of all things. And although it doesn't have a particularly prominent or linear sense of narrative, all of Han Kang's reflections in this book are structured around a contemplation of the color white and around memories that she has of the death of her older sister in infancy and around a winter writer's residency in an unnamed European city. It's so gorgeous and restrained and quiet in a way that some experimental books often are not, and I think it's all the more powerful for its subtlety. And I feel like every Han Kang book that I've read has surprised me and delivered in unexpected ways, and this book is no exception. Those were my absolute favorite nonfiction reads of the year. Let me know some of yours, and I will see you tomorrow with my top fiction reads of 2018. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you soon. Bye!